Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. It is Tuesday, May 12th, 2015, and I'm Leanne McAdoo. Here are tonight's top stories.
Tonight, Marco Rubio channels James Clapper and lies about the NSA's spying, while defense, intelligence, and homeland security officials are involved in constructing a matrix-like simulation of you. Then, an interview with the executive producer of Amerageddon.
And people like you.
I am an American.
All that and more on tonight's InfoWars Nightly News.
The perception has been created, including by political figures that serve in this chamber, that the United States government is listening to your phone calls or going through your bills on them as a matter of course. That is absolutely categorically false. The next time that any politician, senator, congressman, talking head, whatever it may be, stands up and says that the U.S. government is listening to your phone calls or going through your phone records, they're lying. It just is not true. Except for some very isolated instances in the hundreds of individuals for whom there is reasonable suspicion that they could have links to terrorism.
So that was Senator Marco Rubio, said to be the favorite of Republican voters in 2016, making an argument for extending the unconstitutional NSA surveillance program. He's coming right out and saying it, that there's no documented case of abuse with this program. Now, obviously ignoring at the very least the fact that we know agents have been passing around nude photos of American citizens, as well as using these programs to spy on their own significant others. But he's also conveniently ignoring the fact that this surveillance program has been set up from the very beginning without the consent of Congress or the American people. Now, the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit ruled just last week that the NSA surveillance program is rogue and is not authorized by Section 215 of the Patriot Act. The court ruling reads, "We hold that the text of 215 cannot bear the weight the government asks us to assign to it, and that it does not authorize the telephone metadata program." Now, despite the insistence of Senator Rubio, the NSA program has no discernible impact on preventing terrorist attacks. Now, quoting Edward Snowden from 2013, he said these programs were never about terrorism. They're about economic spying, social control, and diplomatic manipulation. They are about power. And obviously, you can just look at the programs and how they've been using the surveillance program instead of focusing on catching actual terrorists, like stopping the Sarnia brothers from the bombing the Boston Marathon. They chose to spy on the nonviolent Occupy crowds or Alaskans for Peace. They were spying on a protester who was writing on the sidewalk with chalk. They were spying on a Mother's Day peaceful protest, as well as veganism, vegan potlucks, and things like that. And we know that they've been spying on the militia and veterans as well. So all of this was going on while the FBI was being given a second warning from Russia about Tsarnaev's ties to terrorism. Obviously he went on to then bomb the Boston Marathon, but they were focused on vegan potlucks and, of course, going after veterans and things like that. That's what they're using this surveillance program for. That's what this is about, controlling political dissidents. They'll allow us to exercise our First Amendment inside of our little free speech zones, but they're never going to allow us to either gather up enough momentum to actually overthrow the powers that be. And that's what this program is all about. That's what the Jade Helm Mastering the Human Domain is all about. Now, Rand Paul has come out saying that he is going to filibuster any attempt to reauthorize the sections of the Patriot Act that are permitting this dragnet surveillance. He says, "We will be filibustering. We will be trying to stop it. We are not going to let them run over us." And he's going to be joined by Senator Ron Wyden, who also said that he's going to filibuster any straight authorization of the bill. And there are only going to be 10 legislative days left for them to do anything about this. This bill is set to expire June 1st. So the question is, are they going to allow this to expire? Are they going to let the USA Freedom Act, which is just a watered-down version of the Patriot Act, are they going to let that take its place? The House is expected to vote on the USA Freedom Act tomorrow. It is expected to pass. Now, following the court's ruling last week, the Electronic Frontier Foundation pulled its support of the USA Freedom Act because they're now urging Congress to roll the draft back to an earlier version of it where it had more stronger and meaningful reforms. And they're really urging Congress to take into consideration the opinion of the Second Circuit Court there, limiting Section 215. So obviously, we're seeing a lot of activity happening this week, and there's still plenty of opportunity for people to call in to their elected representatives. One of the big issues with rolling back the Patriot Act and, of course, setting limits on Section 215 is that they need Section 215. They need that telephone metadata in order to master the human domain. They need that program to scoop up all of our information because that is what is helping them with their surveillance program, which we're gonna talk about this coming up in the next break. They're actually using this to create a matrix-like reality, simulating a virtual reality where each and every one of us are being categorized in this virtual reality, of course, without our consent. Now, something else that's going on today, they were voting on whether or not to debate giving Obama fast-track authority for the TPP, but the Senate Democrats filibustered that today. They filibustered Obama's trade bill, and they blocked what was basically the first major free trade vote in years. Now, obviously, this is really weird when you have conservatives working to push this through while the president's own party is now on the fringe. Now, the Democrats are saying that they don't want any legislation to come unless some other bills are coming along with it, which will include customs enforcement, as well as punishments for any countries who are caught trying to manipulate their currencies for trade advantages. But also, there's this other big thing in the bill. They want another bill to protect American workers who will be displaced by free trade. So do not ignore that. They absolutely know that this is going to be devastating for American workers. We've seen that before with NAFTA. We've seen what's happened. We have massive debt right now. Actually, our debt is higher than the entire economy of China, which is the world's largest economy. Our debt has trumped that. So that right there is frightening. But the fact that the Democrats are pushing for some provisions to be put in place to protect the American worker. So again, they know that this is going to be devastating for the American worker. They want to put these protections in place, which amounts to even more government welfare programs, because what are we going to do for jobs? And so that's what this is really all about. At least they're thinking about us. But this is absolutely when it is time to call your representatives up. Obviously, this is a big vote. They know a lot of people are paying attention to this. Just like so many of you went the extra mile, called your representatives, called the mainstream media and asked them why weren't they talking about Jade Helm, we need to do the same thing with this trade agreement. If you've got a Republican representative, demand that they explain just how this is going to be good for your community, good for your state. What's their plan for jobs in the future and how is that going to affect you? We really need to get people talking about this, and we can't just take Obama on his word for it that this is a good deal. Obviously, you know, things are a little bit shady when his entire party is against it. And this is the one time that the Republicans and he have been able to work together. So obviously, a little bit weird there. Now, stick around because Rob Dew is going to be joining me in studio. We are going to be talking about a U.S. government developed matrix-like reality, okay, where they are using a virtual you. They are simulating a reality with a virtual you. Without our consent, of course. And we're going to talk about how that ties in to Jade Helm. City of Austin tap water versus filtered City of Austin tap water.
I can, like, taste dirt in it.
God knows what's in this.
This has an aftertaste. Tastes like Austin water.
Yeah, it does. Ugh.
These people just sampled City of Austin tap water straight from the faucet. Next, we had them try a sample of tap water filtered through the ProPure G2.0 filtration system.
High quality H2O.
That one is better.
Tastes like nothing.
Yep, I know what good water tastes like. It's good water.
Most tap water contains added substances like fluoride, chlorine, Monsanto's deadly pesticide, glyphosate, and many others.
Studies prove that these substances are linked to an assortment of major health issues, including tooth decay, lowered IQ, and even cancer.
It tastes like you're drinking out of the lake when you drink tap water.
Yeah, it has that processed flavor to it.
The ProPure G2.0 filtration system removes these deadly substances and many more, leaving only fresh-tasting, deliciously clean water.
Okay, this is very tasty.
It's good water. Refreshing.
It's good.
Go to InfoWarsStore.com today. Use promo code WATER and save 10% off your ProPure purchase. Again, that's InfoWarsStore.com or call 1-888-253-3139.
The knowledge of the ancients, tried and true, trusted herbs and extracts fused with the latest nutraceutical science. Introducing the all-new Ancient Defense Herbal Immunity Blend, crafted with over 14 key ancient herbs and extracts to supercharge and prepare your body for what experts admit is the most dangerous season of the year. We have rejected hundreds of other formulations in our quest to bring you what is simply the most powerful and comprehensive proprietary formula that we have ever created in the realm of herbal immunity. For the last 2 years, our team has been working with top doctors, nutritionists, and chemists to develop the ultimate nutraceutical formulation. Experience the benefits of combining over 14 ancient herbs and extracts with exciting new advances in nutraceutical science. For a limited time, get 25% off on this introduction offer. Visit AncientDefense.com or call 888-253-3139. AncientDefense.com.
Well, according to a recent Rasmussen poll, nearly half of the voters who were polled think that the feds are going to use the Jade Helm exercise to exhibit more control over states. Now, this poll is also showing that it's just a mere 21% of people believe that the exercises are an infringement on people's rights who live in those states. And 62% of people say, nah, it's completely fine. Now, obviously, a lot of this has to do with the fact that the establishment media is really playing this down. And they're really playing down the fact that this is an infringement upon people's rights.
I think it has a lot to do with the fact that the NBA Finals are in and people just want to watch that. And they're not interested in what's really going on in the world.
Yeah.
And I think that's The majority of the people don't care.
And they have no idea that they don't know.
And they don't even know what Jade Helm is. We're going to play this clip a little bit later of the colonel, head of the asymmetrical warfare unit, had no idea what Jade Helm was. At least he admitted it on TV that he had no idea what it was.
Yeah, the head of asymmetric warfare. I just really have no... We don't do... Well, we protect your constitutional rights. That's what we do here.
Yeah.
We don't get involved in any of those training exercises. Now, 52% of these people say that they're not worried at all about these exercises. They don't believe there are any ulterior motives behind them. But I think that that's a little bit disturbing because that's what we keep trying to let people know is that this is not normal. And there's a reason why we have been continually attacked in the mainstream media from all angles. I mean, we even had the White House spokesperson come out and speak about this Jade Helm exercise, tell people not to believe what you hear on the internet. And we've talked about these training exercises a lot. So why are they so concerned about shutting down any kind of talk about this one?
Well, I think one thing is that once the governor got involved and said something, that broke a whole new news cycle. Because originally Fox came out with their little piece right when we put ours out. And let me tell you, the life cycle of this whole Jade Helm exercise, I guess I'm kind of responsible for it because I was sent an email that had the slides in there and I looked at them. And I printed it out and I handed it to Joe Biggs. I said, check these out. This came from a credible source. And he looked at it and he goes, hey, they're listing Texas as hostile on the map. I said, go give it to Jones immediately. And that sparked it. I mean, it went off from there and it kind of carried on a life of its own. Now, I think there were a couple other radio shows maybe discussing it before there, but they didn't quite have the reach that we have. So I'm going to say InfoWars blew it out the airlock into the open world and really got people talking about this. And since then, we've been attacked vigorously. This latest example is from The Five, and they did a whole 4-minute segment on it. I've cut it down a bit, but I want to play this for everybody, and then we can analyze it. And then I have even a response from Alex Jones, who I don't even think saw this clip, but he kind of responded in his own way to the things they were attacking him about. So let's go to that clip.
There are all kinds of conspiracy theories floating around about an upcoming Pentagon training exercise called Operation Jed Helm 15. It's a program that's going to run 8 weeks in 7 states beginning in July with troops practicing certain military maneuvers.
Look, this is inspired. Certain the Jed maneuvers. Helm 15 conspiracy theorists are inspired by Alex Jones, the nutjob radio guy who actually was asked to go on to ABC and didn't, for some reason over the weekend, didn't show up for that segment. Look, Alex Jones is a 9/11 truther. He's an Oklahoma City truther, and any opportunity he can to perpetuate a conspiracy theory, he will.
This is all being done to distract us from the chemtrails. The chemtrails are what's ruining us. By the way, the thing that kills me about conspiracy theorists is they believe that they reflect like a higher intelligence or a higher skepticism or a sense of awareness, when in fact every conspiracy theorist you know is gullible. They're the guys that always forward you the email that's been forwarded 1,000 times.
I'm just
raising questions. And they're always talking about false flag operations. And they're so insulting and cruel, like Alex Jones, saying that what happened in Boston, after when the bodies were still fresh, was a false flag operation performed by the FBI, while these people are mourning their dead.
Right.
They're the worst, and they're the most gullible and the dumbest people. I can't stand them.
I just don't, even talking about Abbott, the current governor, I actually think that they're in a position of responsibility to give some tough love. So what you just said about Alex Jones, nut job, this is not true. That actually should have come from them.
Agreed.
That should not from the five. I mean, the five, we can...
Who are we?
Who are the five but a bunch of teleprompter reading puppets?
They can't even read the teleprompter.
Right. She said Jud Helm. Yeah. And I mean, that just sums up what we're dealing with. You know, kind of two-bit morons talking on TV about, I don't know, nothing. They're just trying to cover up the fact. One, they talk about false flags. How many times have we exposed different false flags? Let's go look at the Boston bombing, for instance.
And not only that, someone that they have on their panel plenty of times, Judge Napolitano, was the one that talks about how
the FBI
at least 17
people.
of the terror attacks.
Well, that was a couple years ago. It's been more since then.
Yeah.
I mean, every time there's always a new it's a drill, and then they catch somebody, and it's done by an informant. It always does it. Well, here, the Boston Marathon bombings. So it says here they took place at 2:49 p.m. Eastern on April 15, 2013. Then the Boston Globe comes out with a tweet at 2:53, and you can zoom in on that right there. 2:53, 2:49, I'll put them together. And they go, there will be a controlled explosion opposite the library within 1 minute as part of bomb squad activities. Well, how did the bomb squad know there were bombs over at the library, like 4 minutes after the bombings went off? Don't you think they were there helping people? No, the bomb squad was finding more bombs all of a sudden.
Right. But then it turns out it wasn't a bomb. It was just some construction going on or something.
Exactly. But they put that out. It was officials.
Yeah.
And then officials, there they are. And then we had the Boston Marathon runner, police warned of training exercise. And Anthony Gucciardi put this out same day at 6:02. And the guy was talking about bomb sniffing dogs that were already on the scene before explosions. We interviewed the guy. He went out on local media and talked about this.
And talked about it immediately.
Yeah.
Without any, he had never talked to us initially.
Right.
He said this on his own.
Crazy
his own
conspiracy theorist.
That he didn't think that there was anything wrong with it because there was someone there at the end of the race saying, don't worry about the drill. And
right. And so there we just kind of blew away that. And then talking about Oklahoma City. We've exhausted, I think, the amount of coverage we could do on Oklahoma City. We've carried films on it. Alex has done films on it. I've watched the footage myself that was being shot by the news crew saying, look, there's a second and third bomb inside. We're going to go get them. And then it became a truck bomb. Well, it became a car bomb and then a truck bomb.
Right.
And it just magically changes to fit the narrative, just like the Obama killing. Everything changed to fit the narrative. So
exactly.
It's like...
And it comes out later. And now NBC is also saying... that, yeah, Cy Hirsch is right. We can second his account of what happened. We've done our own investigation as well. And just like you say, it's always moving the
goalposts. And he's being attacked as a conspiracy theorist.
Absolutely.
So that's their big attack. They have to go out and say conspiracy theorists.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's Alex Jones from yesterday talking about how he met with Greg Abbott's, I think it's his press secretary, or one of his right-hand guy. He's on there on stage with him. I forget the guy's name right top of my head. I was putting all this together last minute. But let's go to Alex right now talking about what he thinks about this, and he talks about the ABC, media scam that they pulled on him. So here it is.
If you go to the top of drudgereport.com, you see that Jed Helm is the top story. Texas bristles at Obama invasion. Fears fester. Rand Paul plays down comments on military exercise. governor working to calm the public. I just so happened, as fate would have it, to be downtown this morning, and I ran into Daniel Hodge, the chief of staff for Governor Greg Abbott. And I talked to him a few weeks ago, but then I just so happened to run into him and talk to him for a few minutes. We're picturing him there behind the governor from the Texas Tribune photo. And I said, what do you think of this whole Jade Helm thing? He said, well, we just put out the facts. We're going to guard people's basic rights, and we're just moving on. The media wants to make stuff up they can. We're going to worry about the new legislature and trying to get more jobs to Texas and to keep taxes low. And I went on to talk about the hoax they ran, claiming that I wouldn't show up for this week with George Stephanopoulos. He had a fill-in guest yesterday. As if I wouldn't show up to a live TV program. They said it was live. They backed out of it. They said taped. I said no. Then they sent a car right before one text. Sent Nico a text 45 minutes before saying, where is he? Just classic. This is the type of dirty tricks these people run.
Yeah, so there's Alex answering those charges of about the ABC thing, and then the governor, they were answering what their constituents were saying.
Exactly.
They're saying, hey, we're concerned about this.
There's a ton of
people at that Bastrop meeting that were concerned about it.
So many people, and so many people here in Texas were very vocal about why are we being seen as hostile? How is this going to affect our constitutional rights, our property rights? We're very concerned about it, and that's all he said, and he didn't even want to make a big deal out of it.
And the question no one ever answers, which David Knight and I sat here last week, and for an hour we answered this question about Master of the Human Domain, which is the final slide in the Jade Helm slides that were released by the Army that we just showed. We just took them on script and showed them to everybody. And that is a long-standing plan of geographers and psychopath Army men and PSYOP officers getting together, trying to figure out how they can have real-time battlefield intelligence for wherever the battlefield may be, which is coming to a town near you. Because that's where they've been training. They've been training everywhere in the United States.
Yeah, and a lot of people are, you know, they're attacking us and saying, well, you know, ISIS is there, so aren't you going to be happy when they're doing these drills when ISIS attacks? Or the fact that urban unrest experts are saying that, you know, 96% of Americans believe that there is going to be a lot of civil unrest and riots this summer. Going to be a long, hot summer of civil unrest. And so people are saying, you know, well, aren't you going to be glad they're in place? Well, then it's just going to be the same thing, that they're running a drill when they know something else is
going to happen.
And we're so lucky because we were already in position.
Turns out the shooters in Texas, they were known to an FBI informant.
FBI warned the local police hours before.
Something might happen.
Hey, this guy might show up.
And who took him out? A guy with a handgun, Second Amendment.
Right.
You know, that's what did it. So now, this came out today with C-SPAN. Jade Helm 15 military exercises. Dan Lamont, who's a writer for the Washington Post, they bring him on, and he kind of looks like a tenderfoot. I think this guy's younger than me, even, and I kind of feel young myself these days. But, you know, they bring him out there as the expert to talk about these military exercises, although he has been embedded with troops in Afghanistan. He's pretty well-versed, but he's basically just a teleprompter reading puppet like the rest of these guys. He's getting faxes in, and they're telling him what to write. So the first clip is his explanation of Jade Helm and how this is the first ever of its kind, but then later on, he says it's routine. And then I want to play some of the callers that call in that bring up some interesting points that they don't really address. They just kind of, oh, you said something incredible that we should talk about? Like, no, we're going to put that over here and not talk about it.
It's like the Hillary laugh.
Exactly, exactly.
What is your point, caller?
Right, so let's go to this first clip.
Dan Lamont is a national security writer for the Washington Post, and he joins us now to talk about Jade Helm 15 and some of the concern it sparked in certain corners of the internet as well. Dan Lamont, first, what is Jade Helm? When and where is it taking place?
Okay. Jade Helm is a brand new exercise that's beginning in June. It includes about 1,200 special operations troops. It's going to span a good portion of the Southwest, Texas, Utah, Southern California, a lot of the other areas in between. And I mean, really what the military says they're looking to do is kind of work on how they interact around the public. Some of it is covert. They'll be in, you know, civilian attire and you know, just trying to blend in. They've done other exercises that are similar, but this one kind of sticks out because it's a the scope and size of it is a little bit larger.
And why is the scope and size larger? Why is it different from other ones they've done in the past?
Remember the other exercise, you'll see, 100 troops or 200 troops or something like that. But what they say is that they're looking to prepare for, long-range inserts where you'll take a helicopter from, for the sake of argument, Utah and land it in Texas. Or things along those lines. I mean, they're trying to prepare for future operations that may or may not come up overseas. And I think we can take them at face value on a lot of that.
Yeah.
So we didn't answer the question, though.
Right.
Why were there so many more troops? And
we just have to trust them, whatever they say. And he's just taking them at face value. But he says a lot of things. He says it's a brand new exercise. And then what's interesting, he talks about how they interact with the public.
Mm-hmm.
How is that training for overseas to interact with the public here in the United States? Wouldn't you bring in actors from other countries or autonomous robots, as we talked about last week at that training center in Fort E.P. Hill?
How are they going to blend in with people in countries where they don't speak the same language?
Exactly.
And
that's what they should be drilling. They should be going.
Where they can't read the street signs.
Right. And then they talk about later on how they might be preparing for stuff in the Pacific. The Pacific is nothing like the Southwest. There's no jungles and swamps in the Southwest, except very few pockets. Or maybe over near Houston, you might find a little bit of that, and on the coast of Texas. But you're not finding swamps. It's desert. It's hilly. It's a lot different terrain than what you're going to find, say over in the Pacific. What that's his excuse for explaining the Jade Helm exercise. But now, a little bit later, he talks about it again. He's saying, well, instead of it being brand new, these are routine. They do this all the time. So here's that clip.
And why is this particular exercise raising concern among people who are worried about what the military is doing in this country?
I think it really comes down to the way this news first came out in March. There were briefing slides that were posted on the internet with a real lack of context. I thought, it was cast as this devious exercise that if it wasn't going to be martial law this summer, it was going to be something where that they're setting the stage for future martial law. And I think a lot of us who, cover the military, spend time around the military, we really have a hard time seeing that. There are things where you can look at it and say, hey, they didn't really tell the truth on this or that, the way a war is going or something like that. But this exercise seems pretty routine.
Yeah, it's pretty routine.
It's routine.
Before it was brand new, but now it's pretty routine that we're just going to have troops embedding themselves, trying to blend in with the public. And obviously, I don't think this guy's been covering a lot, because Alex Jones has been covering this stuff for 20 years now, getting video footage, showing them setting up checkpoints. Hey, I'm an American citizen. Mm-hmm. Please don't put me in the camp. And then we have the gun confiscation drills, they actually went live in Katrina where they were gun confiscating. And then now it's wellness checks where they're going to go door to door and we're just going to perform wellness checks. That's the new drill. And then we had the dirty bomb drill in Richmond, Virginia, where they were going against people who said they're sovereign citizens. They're trucking in 3%er trucks. I mean, how are we not supposed to freak out and go, hey, wait a minute. We should start questioning what our government's doing.
Yeah. And that's the whole thing, is that the media is really trying to downplay this. Oh, it's routine. It's completely normal. I mean, they're bringing in C-SPAN again. It was last week. Now again, this week. Just roll out their experts to just placate the massive amount of people who are concerned about this exercise, and they continue to say martial law, and oh, that's ridiculous, we wouldn't do that. But no one is talking about, I mean, you guys nailed it last week, that this is part of the larger agenda to expand the surveillance state.
It's another notch in the
human domain.
It's a notch in the pegboard. They're going up one step at a time. They're gathering more intelligence. Who's going to work with us? Who's not going to work with us? Let's grab all their Facebook accounts. Let's grab all their tweets. These are the people we want to watch in the future. These people might start fomenting unrest or whatever. But now I want to go to the callers. And what's interesting is the callers were across the board. Some people were definitely skeptical of the drill and what it was. And a lot of people, well, not a lot of people, it was about 50-50. And then about half of them were like, I don't see what the big deal is. These people must be racist because they don't want this happening. That's it. If you don't like the you're a racist because it's Obama. And that's the only thing they could throw at you is if you're racist. But let's go to the first caller that I want to play, and he is from New Jersey, and he's talking about drills that coincide with some of these training seminars where there's a training going on, it's a drill, and then something happens that goes live. So let's go to that one.
Tom is in Bedminster, New Jersey, line for independence. Good morning, Tom.
Hi, good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for C-SPAN. Could I please ask about the coincidence of drills with real-world events? Here's an example. President Reagan's assassination attempt. At the time that occurred, there was a presidential succession drill occurring. Are you familiar with this?
I'm not familiar with the specifics of that, no.
Okay, let me try another one. On 9/11, there were a number of drills occurring, some of which interfered with the air defenses on that day. Are you familiar with them?
Tom, where do you go to read up on these issues? No.
What you reading for?
Where do I go to read up on? Well, Webster Tarpley's book, Synthetic Terror, has a great list of the drills.
So they're trying to discredit them.
I think, you know, to be fair and to be open with journalism, the people who are concerned about these drills, to my way of thinking, have a really good reason to be concerned. The National Defense Authorization Act says the military can arrest people, keep them in custody until the end of hostilities, and not give them a lawyer, not give them a trial, not charge them. This is the law of our country. And you know, this is not traditional constitutional governance.
Let's go to Freddie, Indianapolis, Indiana, line for Democrats. Freddie, you're on with Dan Lamont.
I left this part in here just to show that they don't even answer his questions. They just go to the next caller.
They basically just try to discredit him by saying, oh, where do you go
where do you
to
get your news from?
Because if it's not on the mainstream media, because Lord knows we're not going to cover it, we're not going to do due diligence, and if there's enough of noise from the community to demand that we cover this stuff, all we're going to do is attack the people who are talking.
And did you see the writer's face? He's like...
Yeah, he was like... He almost started
Webster
to go
Tarpley?
There about the 9/11.
Oh, my gosh. Maybe I'm not as well-read as I thought. Maybe I don't know everything. Let's look at some of the claims he made. Let's go to President Reagan at first. Here's from the Houston Post. Reagan wounded. Bush's son was to dine with suspect's brother. And there's a whole bunch. Here's a link of Vox FUX News. The Bush Hinckley Connection archive, and it just goes Associated Press. Bush son had dinner plans with Hinckley brother before shooting. Previous Houston reports link suspect with the Bushes.
Did he have the guy's phone number in his pocket, right?
Well, no, that was actually Barry Seal when he was killed.
Oh.
He had George Bush's home phone number in his pocket. That's a drug dealer. This is the assassin, the attempted assassin of President Reagan. Which would have made George Bush president. Yes, I know. There's a lot of things he's got. He's got his hand on a lot of pies. Family destroyed by assassin's attempt. So all these talk about, I think it's Marvin Bush was meeting with him, was one of the Bushes, one of the Bush sons. No, Neil Bush. And it was all about an oil deal. And actually the Hinckleys had a big oil deal going. And they're about to get fined. Well, and after this shooting, nothing happened. But here's some Webster Tarpley's book. Back at the White House, the principal cabinet officers had assembled in the Situation Room and had been running Crisis Management Committee during the afternoon. Haig, that's Alexander Haig, says he was at first adamant that a conspiracy, if discovered, should be ruthlessly exposed. It was essential that we get the facts and publish them quickly. Rumor was not to be allowed to breed into tragedy. And I'm going to move down a bit. Defense Secretary Caspar Weinberger's memoir noted that the afternoon reminds us of two highly relevant facts. The first is that NORAD exercise simulated an incoming missile attack had been planned for the next day. Weinberger agreed with General David Jones, the chairman of the Joint Chief of Staff, that this exercise should be canceled. Weinberger also recalls that the group in the Situation Room was informed by James Baker that there had been a FEMA exercise scheduled for the next day on presidential succession with the general title Nine Lives. By immediate consensus, it was agreed that this exercise should also be canceled. This was from a 1992 book by Tarpley, The Attempted Coup d'Etat, March 30th, 1981, which is when President Reagan was shot. So there you have a FEMA exercise being run of presidential succession. It's supposed to be run the day after he gets shot. So somebody obviously knew that that was coming out. What's the coincidence? I mean, come on. Really?
Yeah.
He's the first president to be shot since Kennedy.
Right.
I mean, what are the odds? It's a billion and 500 million
to one. Yeah, or NORAD running the drills of terrorists.
Well, and then you've got
the
September 11th. NORAD had drills of jets being used as weapons.
Right.
And this was in USA Today.
At the same time.
Well, they had been running it years before. And then you have Condi Rice getting up saying we had never thought about this happening. Well, NORAD's been running drills for years. And then the day of 9/11, they're running Operation Vigilant Guard.
Right.
So.
No. And it's like we know all of this. But that's the thing is that we have, you know, we have these mainstream media experts saying, where do you get your news? And We've been told not to report on that at all, not to do our own due diligence. So we're just going to make
I'm
you
sorry,
all
I was
feel
wrong.
Like
it
fools.
Was Vigilant Guardian and Global Guardian. Those were the NORAD exercises that were being run yeah. on 9/11. Vigilant Guard was an exercise I covered back in 2010, where Polish troops were working with National Guard troops here to cover, to take out terrorists, essentially, and dirty bomb drills.
So really, I mean, who knows what's going to happen? But they are quite aware that we are all aware. We are going to definitely hold them accountable. And clearly, we have a lot of callers out there who are not afraid to call right into C-SPAN and get in their face and attempt to demand some facts.
Exactly.
But just that's the whole reason why Jones didn't want to go on a pre-recorded
where they would edit things out and take them out of context. Yeah, exactly. So this last caller is a veteran who is in Vietnam, and he said, look, when we go into training, they take us to a base and we train for wherever we're going. Okay. So he brings it out again, like we train where we're going.
Right.
So now they're training in the United States. This is where they're going. People don't seem to get that, but let's go to that clip.
I covered an exercise called Bold Alligator, and it was sort of the same scheme. They had an assault that went ashore from the Atlantic Ocean, and you know, you had, they call it the Treasure Coast scenario, and you had the same sort of thing where, you know, a portion of the Southeast was labeled as, you know, a potentially unsafe area for American troops. They're just trying to, you know, work around, okay, we need to pick a place, prepare for it, assault it, and take over it. It's all a dress rehearsal. It's not, you know, to be taken seriously, I think, in most people's eyes that they've tracked these issues seriously.
I'm a Vietnam vet. I served in our military during Vietnam, a security specialist. Smithsville, when they had this town meeting with these people, they said that the commander used the excuse that they were using this for the terrain. The only problem is we got bases all over the United States, and most of the time when we do these exercises, they'd fly us to these areas that we need to practice in. And so actually, they're lying to the people that they need to use a terrain for these training exercises. We was always flown to where we need to be trained for whatever area we was going into. And so this is not true, what the military or what they're saying to the public. That's why people think that it's going to be a takeover, because Obama does not like Texas. Matter of fact, the states that are standing up to Washington on our borders, this is grounds for the federal government to come in and try to do something against the people.
Yep. And who's been the most vocal about this? We can forget him. He's going to give some whitewash.
Yeah, it's just
excuse. You can go watch the video if you want, and you can watch the whole thing. It's about 40 minutes. But, you know, you see how the people who are in and know what's going on, they're like, wait a minute, this is not normal. We were sent the Jade Helm spreadsheet, those slides, we were sent those by a veteran who said, this is not normal.
Right.
This veteran sees it. It's not normal. This is not normal. And when they sit there and go, oh, if we do this all the time, they really don't.
Yeah, and that we have all, you know, and I am not a veteran, but even to myself, I can say it's not normal. Why would you train amongst the American people if you're going overseas to a country where an American soldier is going to stand out in another right. in another country? And so that's kind of the thing, just bringing this back around. You know, we have almost half of people believing that this does have something to do with a federal takeover. But just look at, you know, the first thing Sharpton said, right coming out of the Ferguson
we need more
unrest
federal government.
And the need, Baltimore. Yes, yeah. He take over the police, federalization of the police. And I mean, it is that. But it's really more about the plan behind it, which is mastering the human domain. And that's why they want to be out amongst the people, see what kind of a response they get. And it's all part of their simulation that they're working on so that they can know what's going on in real time. And again, we see it's not about fighting terrorists overseas. It's about controlling the American people.
And that returning and vets are the enemy. As we go out to break, I know we got David Knight coming up next. Let's go to that C-SPAN clip that shows the general, the colonel from, it was a colonel, Potosik from last week. He has no idea about Jade Helm. He's never heard of it. And then I guess we got, what, David Knight coming up next?
Yes, David Knight is going to be speaking with, I believe, the producer of an upcoming film that Alex Jones stars in. And he actually gets the opportunity to not play an Alex Jones-esque character. I believe that he's actually going to get to play one of these
evil senators
that he's always fighting
against. Wants to spy on you.
I wanted to alert our citizens and to get an explanation, if we could, for an exciting military training called Jade Helm 15, which is all over the internet. I guess it involves 10 states, and there's going to be civilians participating in towns like Big Spring, Texas. Could you explain the magnitude of that and what the purpose of that is? And apparently you're going to have crisis actors, and there are going to be soldiers dressed in uniform and not in uniform, and apparently it's very exciting. Could you explain that to us? Thank you very much.
Unfortunately, it's not something that I'm familiar with, so I can't really explain that. But I do know that those type of things are things that we do here, where we get our soldiers the opportunity to work within an environment where there are civilians and soldiers. As a matter of fact, one of the things I could talk about is that, unfortunately, I just don't know about that particular exercise.
I see nothing. I know nothing.
The Army's plan for a multi-state training exercise this summer called Jade Helm 15. While the military says it's just training soldiers for the realities of war, critics say the Army is preparing for modern-day martial law.
Some are calling it a Texas takeover. What's happening is between July and September, a bunch of Green Berets, Navy SEALs, and special ops from the Air Force and Marines are conducting some realistic training exercises across the Southwest, including 17 different Texas cities.
Again, I'm sorry, I'm just not familiar with that exercise.
Oh, I see nothing. I was not here. I did not even get up this morning.
From the water table, to our soils, to the atmosphere itself, our world is becoming more and more toxic each and every day. But it's not just the air outside that's toxic. Indoor air has been shown to have 2 to 5 times higher concentrations of pollutants than even outdoor air. And most Americans spend 90% of their time inside using toxic chemicals within their homes. There are more than 42 million smokers in the United States. Well over 1,000 types of mold and mildew linked to numerous conditions. And don't forget the fact that 6 million Americans live with pets they're allergic to as well. When I began to research these statistics, it was clear to me it was time to start cleansing my lungs in order to combat the toxic environment that we cannot escape, but that we can fight back against. Made with organic and wild cultivated herbs and manufactured in the USA, the new InfoWars Life Lung Cleanse is here in a convenient spray bottle that can be brought with you throughout any toxic environment. Now available exclusively at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. For all of recorded history, civilizations around the world praised the health benefits of silver. At InfoWars Life, our mission is to bring you the highest quality, purest, cleanest, effective colloidal silver on the market today for the lowest price available. When it comes to you and your family's health, InfoWarsLife.com is very excited to announce our biggest run yet of Silver Bullet Colloidal Silver, exclusively available at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, InfoWarsLife.com has taken colloidal silver to the next level using a cutting-edge technique that is free of toxic artificial additives. Now more than ever, it's important to stock up on high-quality Silver Bullet from InfoWarsLife.com and to help others during Christmas by teaching them about the powerful benefits of silver. Secure your Silver Bullet today at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139.
Joining us today is Gary Haven. Now, he's an entrepreneur who created one of the largest franchises in the world, Kerr's, very successful franchise. We're going to talk to him about his second career now, and a career as an executive producer of films, writer, actor in the film Amerigeddon. Now, this is in post-production right now. It's going to be coming out in November 2015. And Alex Jones is in it, really kind of playing against type. He's playing a corrupt big government senator who's kind of your nemesis in this. Interesting to see him playing that kind of a role.
Yeah, the movie opens up with a scene in front of a Senate hearing. And I'm the star and the entrepreneur that sees this thing coming, and I'm challenging the government to act. And Alex plays the evil senator, my nemesis. And I told Alex today that he was particularly evil.
Yeah, well, you know, he's watched them for so long, he really knows what they look like. So even right. though he's playing against type, you know, he certainly does know the type. Now, of course, it's being directed by Chuck Norris's son, Mike Norris. And I think one of the most interesting things about this is the fact that as you guys were doing this back in January and February, of course, you had written the script long before this. This is well before Jade Helm, and yet in many respects, it parallels a lot of the concerns that we have about Jade Helm. Not that there's going to be an immediate martial law takeover. That's not what we've been saying. We've been seeing, however, the gradual buildup from the NDAA to the NSA. And I see in all of this a merging with the Special Forces operations. What concerns me really is this mastering the human domain is really merging the analytics from the NSA with the military, with the police state, with Homeland Security. Very concerning to look at that in the context of the NDAA.
There's so many elements here. The courts in America just ruled that the mega data collection was illegal.
Yes.
And they're now about to vote on passing the law that's going to allow this to continue. But let's go back and talk about the movie and how we came to this insight in, mm-hmm. ahead of time. I retired from business and was looking for something to do. And I felt like influencing the culture in a positive way through entertainment
yes.
was something that I had been prepared for. And Mike Norris and I, the director of my movie, he and I sat down about a year ago and began to write a script that was based on things that were happening. The byline of the movie is a true story that hasn't happened yet. Mm-hmm. And the movie talked about and demonstrated things that our government has been doing all along. I'll give you a few examples. The National Defense Authorization Act, which has been passed each year for the last several years. Most people don't know this, but the government has the power to declare an emergency for any reason, and I'm talking about the president.
Yes.
And under that act, he suspends habeas corpus. We have no Fifth Amendment rights if the president declares that so. Mm-hmm. In fact, today, if you're suspected of being a terrorist, and I use the word suspected, you can be arrested. You'll be held without legal counsel, without charges, indefinitely. That is codified into law today in America. That's nuts.
Yes. If we look at that, mm-hmm. remember how this all came to pass. Obama said, I'm not going to sign it if that clause is in there. Then on New Year's Eve, he signs it, and then when people call him on it, he says, don't worry, I'm not going to enforce it. When it was challenged by journalists, they fought tooth and nail to keep it in there. So in that context, that is even more troubling.
Yeah, imagine that. The government, the president would lie to us. You know, and it's become so common that people pretty much accepted it. But in the movie, we really show people the risk that we are at today. Another example would be the Executive Order 13603 that Obama signed in the Congress made no protest about that under an emergency, the government can take everyone's resources, everyone's money, yes. everyone's property, including everyone, and yes. put them to work without pay. These are codified into law. And I tell you, I don't believe that our government, the people in power, would be passing these laws and establishing these policies if they didn't intend to use them one day.
Yes, absolutely.
So the movie is a really neat story because my character sees that the government has plotted to be attacked by an electromagnetic pulse. And that's in the news lately because Cheyenne Mountain has just reopened.
Yes.
The military is going back in there because yes. it's a protected facility from an EMP. So this is stuff that's in the news every day. It's not just from my imagination. Well, in the movie, I'm trying to warn everybody that for a couple $1 billion, you can protect the grid, power grid in America. And the Congress itself had done two studies that said that 90% of Americans would die in 12 months mm-hmm. if we were attacked by an EMP. And this weapon exists in the arsenal of the North Koreans, the Russians, the Chinese, we have it. Mm-hmm. And it's the easiest way to bring down this country, and yet we're doing nothing to protect the American citizenry from what the Congress says is the most imminent threat to this country.
But it looks like the government is doing quite a bit to protect itself. It's not doing anything for civil defense, but it is doing everything for its own defense, whether it's billions of rounds of ammunition, where they could fight 30 years of conflict at the level that they did in Iraq, or whether it is pre-placement of militarized vehicles with all of our small local police departments. You name it, they're protecting themselves, moving to Cheyenne Mountain, that sort of thing. But they're not doing anything to protect us, even simple things.
That's a great point. You know, they said that they're spending $700 million to move back into Cheyenne Mountain. Well, the entire grid for the entire country to protect people is only 2 billion, which, by the way, is what we give to Pakistan each year.
Yeah, exactly. I think what you're doing is incredibly important. And, of course, shortly after I came here, we had the Paul Revere Film Contest, because we know that people get the larger context. We get the ongoing news, and we were talking before the interview, it's kind of an ongoing conversation with the news as things develop, as we've seen Jade Helm developing. But to get the bigger context, people really understand that with a documentary, but we can't get that many people. There's a certain percentage of the population that'll watch documentaries. Mm-hmm. Those people, you can wake up. But there's a large population, percentage of the population that is not going to watch them, that will watch dramatized movies. And that's the key. That's why we wanted to get everybody to work on their chops and trying to do this with 1,000 Paul Reveres. And we had some really good entries in it, but I'm really excited to see a professional film with a big budget coming out like Armageddon.
You know, the byline on the movie is a true story that hasn't happened yet. Mm-hmm. And with the Jade Helm stuff that's going on right now, it's pretty eerie, because we basically demonstrated what happens when the U.S. military violates posse comitatus and begins to operate in domestically in this country, which was prohibited by law up until very recently for good reason. So Jade Helm is an interesting concept, because we predicted it in the movie. I kind of wish the movie had come out last November, then people would be even more aware. Mm-hmm. People would be more thoughtful.
Yes.
Which, by the way, my goal is to get people to begin to think clearly and to think critically.
Yes.
We're not going to change things in the political process, because Washington is bought and paid for through the moneyed interest. And we know that from a study done by Princeton University that researched whether the influence of the average voter determined any of the policies of the government. In Princeton, which is not exactly a conservative bastion, said that the American people have no influence on their government, that it is entirely vested through corporate interest.
And we know that. We can see that. There's so much money, so much power in Washington, that it is a black hole for corruption. It just draws those types of people in. I really don't think we're going to be able to fix it by sending the quote-unquote right people to Washington. I think it's going to have to be contained like a cancer from the outside. I think we're going to see things like state nullification, like jury nullification, like people getting active, getting involved at the local level, but they have to understand the context of it. And it's very important, like you're talking about with your movie here, Armageddon, it's important for the military to understand where their loyalties lie, to understand that they took an oath to the Constitution. We had Oath Keepers rise up as an organization because of the abuses that we saw in the aftermath of Katrina. People were horrified about that if they actually saw what was going on, what was reported by the news. What really has already happened in Katrina is something that should scare everyone.
Absolutely.
And when we combine that with what's going on with the war on drugs, the SWAT team raids that are happening, people getting their property confiscated without even being charged with the crime, they just say, the property is guilty. We're going to do it as a civil action instead of as a criminal action, so there's no due process here. When you have a government that is operating like that, that is operating in secret, that has passed this legal infrastructure like you were talking about with the NDA and other things, we should be very concerned. We should be involved with the mission that our military is being put into. That's supporting the troops, I think.
You know, one of the things that we showed in the movie is our hero is a young lieutenant who is ordered to take weapons away from people under martial law. And he realizes it, and he's ordered to fire on them if necessary. That's an event that's imminent. Mm-hmm. That's what's going to happen. So what we showed was that this young lieutenant could make a decision to protect and defend the Constitution of the United States against enemies, both domestic and foreign, and he makes the decision not to fire on American citizens, not to take their weapons away. And the idea is that a million American soldiers will watch this movie and think about that.
Yes.
In advance of having to make that decision one day, they've had time to think it through.
That is a priceless experience to be able to put that out there, to have people think it through in advance. We know that's what happened in East Germany. That's when the Berlin Wall came down, when you had soldiers who were not willing any longer to fire on civilians. It began with prayer meetings for a long time. And then one day, a bunch of people walk out of the church, walk to the gates, and almost essentially defied them to shoot them. I saw it at the Bundy Ranch. I saw people saying, you're not going to do this to my neighbors anymore. You know, basically walking up there, unarmed, the vast majority of them, the few that had arms, they had them shoulder, but they said, you're not going to taser a man off of a horse. You're going to have to shoot him off. That's their commitment, to passively stand up in the spirit of Gandhi and others, Martin Luther King, to say, we're not going to take this kind of violence directed at us anymore. We're going to be treated like human beings. That's very important for them to understand that in advance, to think through these different moral dilemmas.
You know, the people in power can only operate if we stay ignorant or in fear. And I'm doing my best to educate people so they're not ignorant. And I'm hopeful that people will follow the example that you're doing, that I'm doing, that Alex's doing, and not be afraid of these people.
Absolutely.
You know, there's really three things that people need to know what's going on in this country right now. Number one, Washington is bought and sold to the moneyed interest. There is just no influence that we have anymore. They don't care about us. They're not concerned with the Constitution. Washington's gone. Mm-hmm. And we're blessed that we live in a state, the state of Texas, that still has a respect for the citizens, a respect for the Constitution. In fact, I believe Texas is going to be a sanctuary in the future. And I've had this discussion with the governor and the attorney general. So we're blessed to be here. The second thing people need to be aware of is the mainstream media, 98% of it is owned by six corporations. And these corporations are bought and paid for by the moneyed interest. And they follow a script. And if you rely on the mainstream media for your news, you're a fool today. Mm-hmm. And there's so many examples, whether it's the war in Ukraine, where Putin's the demon and is going in and started this thing. Well, the American government funded the overthrow of the Ukrainian government. We started.
Yes.
And imagine doing this on the border of a nuclear power.
Yes.
You know, how stupid are these people in power? And, you know, they like to portray themselves as being the elite and brilliant. They're the stupidest people, the most foolish people I could ever imagine. And they're the ones that are establishing the world that we live in. And it's nuts.
I would say General Breedlove looks more like Dr. Strangelove. It's almost like they have a death wish. And of course, maybe perhaps they do. That's what Paul Craig Roberts has pointed out. He thinks that they want this war. It's a way that they can remake society. There is something that's going to happen that could remake society, and we have many different pressure points where that could happen. I'm really anxious to see this movie, Amerigeddon. Again, it's going to be released sometime in November. It's in pre-production now.
Yes.
We look forward to be released then.
November 2015. We'll be back on the show to talk about it and let people know how to watch it at that time.
That'll be great. Yeah, the clip that I've seen looks excellent. Thank you so much for doing this. It is a very important way to wake people up. Very important. Thank you so much. Well, that's it for tonight's news. If you're watching this on YouTube, please subscribe to our channel. And if you're not a subscriber to Prison Planet TV, please support us with your subscription. It's a way that you can watch the news every Monday through Friday as it's happening at 7 Central. It's also a way that you can share all of Alex's documentaries with your friends. Up to 20 people can watch this simultaneously. Join us again tomorrow night at 7 Central.
Used since before the days of the Roman Empire to support the body's natural systems and enhance overall health. Introducing the new InfoWarsLife.com oil of oregano formulation, a highly advanced nutraceutical form of this key herb that has been traditionally used by civilizations for thousands of years to promote health. We have now procured the most high quality and potent forms of oregano oil on the market, sourced from top leading manufacturers to ensure a concentrated level of bioactive ingredients. Extracted directly from the wild herb and sealed in easy-to-use capsules, you will no longer need to endure the burning of liquid oregano on the tongue. Wild-crafted from the Mediterranean oregano species that experts agree is one of the most powerful and most challenging to acquire. This winter season, it's more important than ever to secure this true form of oil of oregano. Now available in our limited first run at InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com or call 888-253-3139.
You are watching the InfoWars Nightly News, which airs 7 p.m. Central at InfoWarsNews.com. And your support is helping us defend liberty worldwide.